Hey guys, welcome to my channel. As we all know, the United States was once the undisputed infrastructure superpower. Back in 1913, the U.S. had a staggering 400,000 miles of operational railroads, nearly 40% of the global total at the time. Its highway network also once led the world. Americans have long taken pride in infrastructure icons like the Golden Gate Bridge, a suspension bridge that spanned the San Francisco Bay and was hailed as a modern engineering marvel when it opened in 1937. Likewise, the Hoover Dam, completed in the 1930s, remains a symbol of America's industrial strength. However, since the 1980s, as the economy shifted away from manufacturing and toward financial services, U.S. infrastructure has fallen into a state of disrepair. The American Society of Civil Engineers has consistently rated it no higher than a D+. In contrast, China has never taken its foot off the gas when it comes to infrastructure. In just a few decades, the country has created one engineering marvel after another. From the world's largest high-speed rail network, spanning over 42,000 kilometers, to the record-breaking Hong Kong-Zhuhai-Macau Bridge that links three major cities across the sea. From the Sichuan-Tibet Railway cutting through the treacherous Hengduan Mountains, to the breathtaking Beijing-Daxing International Airport with its Phoenix-inspired design. Through sheer ambition and engineering excellence, China has redefined what it means to be an infrastructure maniac. Now, another monumental project is steadily advancing, the Pinglu Canal. This colossal undertaking is ushering in a new era of construction and national development on an unprecedented scale. In the towering mountains of southwestern China, engineers are carving a massive 135-kilometer canal, cutting straight through rugged terrain to give landlocked cities in Guangxi direct waterway access to the South China Sea. This isn't just about digging a ditch. This is a bold gamble to reshape the region's economic lifeline. It's called the Pinglu Canal, and it's being hailed as the artery of the century. Right now, it's turning this once unthinkable plan into reality. The scale of excavation is nothing short of staggering. Over 340 million cubic meters of earth and rock are being moved, the equivalent of shaving down entire mountain ranges. That's three times the excavation volume of the Panama Canal. At one of the most challenging sections, the Madao watershed, engineers are dealing with a 30-meter elevation difference, blasting through rock and flattening channels like performing surgery on the earth itself. Once completed, this canal will become a new express waterway, connecting the upper reaches of the Xijiang River directly to the sea. Shipping routes from China's southwest to the ocean will be 560 kilometers shorter, saving billions in logistics costs annually. Take Nanning, for example. Cargo will reach the sea 7 days faster, and logistics costs could drop by 30%. But the canal is more than a regional shortcut. As a key node in the maritime Silk Road, it will deepen trade between Southwest China and ASEAN countries. It will also strengthen ties across China's Belt and Road, linking the Beibu Gulf Economic Zone, the Chengdu Chongqing Economic Circle, and the Greater Bay Area, creating an international industrial corridor and sparking economic takeoff across multiple regions. When foreign viewers first saw drone footage of the construction site, many thought they were watching a sci-fi movie or footage of an alien base. A European viewer commented, "This isn't just building a canal. This is redrawing the map of regional economics. China's vision and execution are absolutely mind-blowing." One American viewer was stunned. "Are we still on Earth? This looks like a base on the moon. The CGI is so real, no wonder people thought it was fake." But once they confirmed it was a real project, the tone changed. "This is masterclass engineering. This is how you make a nation great, not by slogans, but by building something that speaks for itself." A German viewer marveled, "I'm speechless. Where is this exactly? I'd love to visit someday." When people learned the canal is expected to be completed by 2026, the comment sections lit up with comparisons. An Australian joked, "This would take us about 400 years to finish down here." And an American chimed in, "On a construction site here, we have 20 workers. One works and 19 supervise." The contrast with China's construction efficiency couldn't be more stark. A Dutch hydraulic engineer named Jan commented, "Coming from a country that has lived with water all its life, I've never seen something this wild and precise at the same time." Meanwhile, a US viewer wrote, "Our infrastructure proposals are still stuck in Congress. China's out here slicing the continent in half with a canal. I surrender. That's execution." If the Pinglu Canal is China's way of rewriting legends into the land, then the Sichuan-Tibet Railway is about challenging the limits of engineering on the rooftop of the world. Spanning 1838 kilometers and reaching altitudes of up to 4,400 meters, the railway must cross 14 seismic fault lines, making it one of the most difficult rail projects ever attempted on Earth. To solve the challenges of building on permafrost in high-altitude regions, Chinese engineers developed an innovative thermal siphon cooling system. By harnessing the principle of ammonia's thermal expansion and contraction, the system draws underground heat away, keeping the frozen soil layer stable. For bridge construction in these harsh environments, they use lightweight alpine steel structures that are 30% lighter than traditional steel, yet strong enough to withstand Category 12 east of winds and Magnitude 8 earthquakes. During the construction of the Erlong Mountain Tunnel, workers wore oxygen tanks on their backs and used pneumatic drills to chip away at the solid rock inch by inch, enduring temperatures as low as minus 20 degrees C. They went on to set a world record, advancing 350 meters in a single month under such extreme conditions. The completion of the Sichuan-Tibet Railway will dramatically improve connectivity between Tibet and the rest of China, boosting economic development, cultural exchange, and helping lift communities along the route out of poverty. Railway enthusiasts across the West have praised it as a monumental victory of mankind over nature. Some even called it a miracle built in one of the most impossible environments on Earth. However, certain Western media outlets and commentators have painted a different picture. Some labeled the railway one of the most expensive projects in the world, implying that China is overspending to show off. Others linked it to the 100th anniversary of the Communist Party, calling it a lavish political gift. There have even been rumors claiming the railway will destroy local traditions by flooding the region with tourists, or that the Chinese military might use it to threaten neighboring countries. But these claims are baseless, rooted in prejudice and jealousy, not facts. Throughout the long and storied history of human engineering, tales of pain and sacrifice have never been absent. In the 1930s, during the construction of the Hoover Dam in the United States, 120 lives were lost to the cold grip of concrete, and countless more were injured. At the Panama Canal, tens of thousands of workers perished, 30,000 men, claimed by the deadly combination of tropical disease and grueling labor under the sweltering jungle heat. Looking further back, China's Great Wall, winding across the mountains for thousands of miles, was built atop an immeasurable human cost. Buried beneath the earth and stone are the silent remains of those who gave their lives, whispering stories of suffering beneath each brick and battlement. But with time, the meaning of engineering has evolved. In modern-day China, the principle of people first, life above all, has become central to every project. Every life is treated as invaluable. This deep respect for human life was fully embodied in the construction of the Qinghai-Tibet Railway, the world's highest altitude rail line, built across the Tibetan plateau at an average elevation of 4,000 meters. As soon as construction began on this sky road, it presented an unprecedented challenge to the nation's medical and safety systems. In this forbidden zone of life, where thin air and sub-zero temperatures can silently claim a life within moments, even a single breath carried potential danger. But Chinese builders did not choose to push forward at the cost of lives. Instead, they drew a line of defense with science, planning, and care. On a site with over 200,000 workers, medical teams were stationed throughout every stage of the project. Portable oxygen generators, mobile treatment units, regular health checkups, and emergency response systems were deployed to every work zone. Every protocol reflected a commitment to life, every detail a testament to the value placed on human dignity. In the end, China not only conquered three world-class engineering challenges, permafrost, extreme altitude, and fragile ecosystems, but also achieved a miracle in safety, zero deaths from altitude sickness. This wasn't just a victory for engineering. It was a living demonstration of a core belief that no achievement is worth more than a single human life, and that even in the pursuit of national development, China will never compromise on protecting its people. The construction of the Qinghai-Tibet Railway is widely regarded as one of the greatest feats in the history of global railway engineering. However, during its development, some Western media outlets went to great lengths to exaggerate claims of casualties during the project, attempting to distort the true meaning and significance behind China's efforts in building this monumental railway. Their coverage was often laced with sarcasm and suspicion, as if struggling to accept that China had managed to complete a project of such extreme technical and geographical difficulty. Some foreign netizens also echoed false narratives. One South Korean commenter even claimed that if Korea had built this railway, it would have taken half the time, while also alleging that over 3,000 workers died from altitude sickness. But the truth tells a very different story. During the first phase of the Qinghai-Tibet Railway, it's true that China faced harsh environmental conditions and lacked the advanced resources we have today. According to official data, 179 workers lost their lives, and 633 were injured during this early stage, when engineers had to battle severe permafrost, high altitude, and extreme weather with limited technology. But by the time construction of the second phase began in 2001, the situation had changed dramatically. China's financial, technical, and medical capabilities had all improved significantly. Participating construction firms implemented comprehensive health and safety systems to protect every worker involved. Dr. John West, vice president of the International Society for High Altitude Medicine, described the Golmud Lhasa section of the railway as one of the most challenging high altitude projects ever built, comparable, in his words, to the Great Wall of China in the sky. China invested heavily in studying and treating acute and chronic altitude sickness, building a full medical infrastructure around the project. They promoted on-site emergency care protocols, which dramatically reduced the incidence of deadly conditions such as high-altitude cerebral edema and pulmonary edema. Over 3 years of continuous construction, more than 100,000 workers took part in building the railway, and not a single life was lost due to altitude-related illness. This shocked even Western medical experts. A Chinese Academy of Engineering academic later pointed out, when the project reached elevations above 4,500 meters, we had 14,000 people working, and not a single death from hypoxia. Ironically, over 100 fatalities occurred due to car tire blowouts, not from altitude. To fight oxygen deprivation, construction teams deployed everything, from personal oxygen bags, to cylinders, to oxygen generation stations, and even hyperbaric chambers. Over the 5 years of phase two construction, workers used up 600,000 oxygen tanks, a powerful symbol of how science and compassion came together to protect lives. The Qinghai-Tibet Railway was not just an engineering triumph. It was a triumph of will, science, and deep respect for life. Those who try to discredit it with false claims are quickly silenced by the facts. This railway has become more than just a symbol of China's infrastructure strength. It represents humanity's victory in confronting the limits of nature without sacrificing human dignity. Still, some Western media continue to label the project as a political stunt. They claim it was built merely to elevate China's leadership image, ignoring the deeper purpose behind it: to promote regional development, connect remote areas, and foster national unity. In one article, the New York Times argued that the railway would accelerate Han-led economic development in Tibet and claimed it would choke the region's ancient spiritual civilization. They even warned that the railway might further accelerate the migration of Han Chinese into Tibet, calling it a tool for state control. Some Western media even went so far as to claim that the Qinghai-Tibet Railway threatens the very existence of Tibetan and Buddhist culture. Tibetans' unique way of life will disappear. That must be was their warning. But what do you think? Do these narratives reflect reality, or are they fueled by misunderstanding and bias? Let us know your thoughts in the comments below. We'd love to hear your perspective on this project and what it truly represents for China, for Tibet, and for the world. So how is China defining the next century of human progress? While the US is still fixing highways from the last century, China is already exploring the ultimate future of infrastructure. With each mega project built, China continues to overcome world-class engineering challenges through innovative techniques and advanced construction methods, earning it the moniker Infrastructure Maniac. Moreover, China has undertaken major projects in numerous other countries, each emblematic of its development drive. Behind China's global leadership in infrastructure lies not only a leap in technology, but also the support of a mighty nation. For over a century from the devastation at the founding of the People's Republic of China, it has been the successive struggles of generations of Chinese engineers that have painted the picture of today's prosperous China. And yet, this is not the end for China. In the future, the infrastructure maniac will continue to help more developing countries modernize, create new opportunities for development, and build a better, more livable world for all. Each bridge, every road, and every project connects cities and countrysides. The present and the future, China and the world. Chinese infrastructure has not only reshaped the face of China, but also exemplified the strength, spirit, and speed of the nation. The infrastructure maniac will never stop. What miracles do you think Chinese infrastructure will create in the next decade? Please share your thoughts in the comments.